the Himalayan system, which is also referred to as North Indian Mountains, is a major physiographic division of India, and we can call that it's an identity of India, because this is the mountain system which separates India from rest of the Asia, and we usually call ourselves as Indian subcontinent. Now, how really this Indian subcontinent is separated from rest of Asia is because of the Himalayan mountain system. So, Himalayas are one of the loftiest and majestic and recent mountain systems, which were produced because of the collision between the Indian plate and the Eurasian plate. And as we all know, that Indian plate was the one which was moving and Eurasian plate was stationary. The impact, now this produced the typical feature of Himalayas. The simple question which you should ask is that why Himalayas have the lesser mountain chains only in south and why not in north? Why in north they end abruptly and they end in a high plateau? Now the answer for this is is that only the southern Indian plate was moving and Eurasian plate was stationary. So impact was from south, the collision that occurred was from south, and there was intermediate Sea of Tethys, which is usually referred to as, and this Sea of Tethys got cramped within these two plates. Now the Indian plate never had a perfectly east-west kind of a flat boundary or a straight boundary. It was pointed kind of a boundary, and therefore there was a point of collision and not a front of collision. So when Indian plate collided with the Eurasian plate, there was a point of collision, and this point of collision lies in the present day Karakoram system, where we have K2 and Kasherbrum, these peaks. That is where that was the point of collision. And so you will find that this area has got origin of many mountain systems, many mountain ranges. They originate in this, and this is usually called as Karakoram Knot. It's a knot kind of a thing, and most rugged Himalayas are present in Karakorams, not around Everest. So you get highest peaks and lowest passes. So the rugged Himalayas are at this point of collision. Now after the Himalayan or the Indian plate collided, it moved towards east. Now this movement towards east produced was actually a rotational kind of movement around the axis or point of collision. And because of that, the movement was rotational, and Himalayas, they got an arc shape. This arc shape of Himalayan system is because of the rotation of Indian plate after the collision. And it produced arc bending towards south, and the plate came to rest. But after that, there was a secondary collision, and this secondary collision was actually shifting towards east. Now this shifting towards east has produced the eastern Himalayan ranges like Lushai, Patkaibum, all those kind of things. So the collision, you can divide collision into three different stages. One was the point or the first impact, the second was the rotational movement, this produced what is called as a flexure, and third was the shifting towards the east. It is also called as resettlement of Indian collision, and it produced the lesser mountain ranges of eastern Himalayas, which are running from north to south instead of east to west. So Naga Hills are the one of the examples. So this is how the collision took place, and this collision produced, majority of it produced what we have present day greater Himalayas. Now the secondary collisions, they produced the middle Himalayas, and Shivaliks, which are the third part, are the product of not collision, but it's a product of the material, or it's a product of erosion of Himalayas. So Himalayas are produced in three stages, and the Himalayan ranges are also produced in three different stages. Now we can classify or we can divide Himalayan mountain by using different schemes of classification or using different criteria. The usual scheme of classification is based on altitude. So you have foothills, which are also known as Shivaliks, and the average altitude of Shivaliks is around 900 to 1100 meters. But Shivaliks are not continuous chain of hills. There are some regions where you don't have Shivaliks, and they are broken chains, and Shivaliks are not aligned east to west. Instead of that, you will find that Shivaliks are more or less haphazard. They don't have any pattern as such, and they are cut north-south by different rivers. So in Shivaliks, you get valleys running north-south, and these valleys or the valley mouths are usually called as dunes. So you have a Dehradun at the mouth of a valley, because at this point the sediment that is brought from Himalayas is spread out, because the rivers, they flow in mountains. When they flow in mountains, they have very high velocity, and suddenly they enter the plains, and once they enter the plains, they lose the velocity. Because they lose the velocity, they lose the energy, and whatever material they have brought is just spread out, and this spread out material is called as a dune. So we have a Dehradun, we have Harki Dune. There are many dunes in Himalayas, but this is speciality of Himalayas, of what are called as Garhwal, Kumaon and Punjab Himalayas only. You don't get similar dunes in Kashmir, you don't get similar dunes in Arunachal or Sikkim. So this is the variety that we get, and we have Shivaliks. Now Shivaliks are made up of the colluvial material, or the material that is brought by rivers, or the material that is brought from mountains, and so there is no sorting of material. Now usually these Shivaliks are covered by the forest. Now depending upon the altitude and depending upon the latitude, the type of forest changes. But you have dense forest in Shivaliks, and these forests, they correspond to, or they are very similar to the deciduous kind of forest that you get in rest of India. Higher parts of course have some transition towards conifers, but usually you have this deciduous kind of forest. So these are the Shivalik systems. As you go in, you get Central Himalayas, and Central Himalayas are characterized by ranges which are more or less east to west and parallel to the Greater Himalayas. Now these ranges have got different names. For example, you have a Jaskar range which starts from Himachal and goes into Kashmir. Then you have Pir Panjal range. You have many such ranges in Central Himalayas, and Central Himalayas actually occupy larger area in India rather than the Greater Himalayas. So Central Himalayas have snow-clad peaks, because in Shivaliks you don't get any snow, but in Central Himalayas you have snow-clad peaks. The seasonality of snow is more in case of Central Himalayas, and you will find that the average altitude of Central Himalayas ranges from 4000 meters to 6000 meters depending upon whether it is in Eastern Himalayas or Punjab Himalayas or Kashmir Himalayas. It differs. And this snow line is in Central Himalayas. So the permafrost conditions, they start within the mid-Himalayan system. And of course, because we have permafrost conditions, we also have a tree line. Now, majority of the tourist places, they are in these mountain ranges on their southern slopes. These are occupied by the coniferous forest, and the conifers, depending upon altitude, have variety like this. It starts from weeping willow pine and may continue up to cheed, spruce and deodars. In higher areas, you have rhododendrons which take place of these deodars, and if you move still higher, then you have seasonal grasses and some algal growth. So this is how the vegetation changes according to altitude in case of Central Himalayas. These have the midline peaks. Now the highest peaks in India, present in India, are usually in Central Himalayas, and they have peaks of around 6000 meter altitude. For example, you have Kamet in Central Himalayas, and these kind of peaks you have, and the major places in Central Himalayas are Kulu, Manali, Darjeeling, Tawang. These are the places. Beyond Central Himalayas, you have loftiest parts, and those are called as Greater Himalayas. Now Greater Himalayas are more continuous than Central Himalayas, but major part of Greater Himalayas lies in Nepal and beyond Sikkim and in present day Pak occupied Kashmir and China. So this is how you have distribution. There is very small part of proper Greater Himalayas in India, and that lies in Uttarakhand, to some extent in Himachal and in Sikkim around Kanchenjunga. So this is how we have the Greater Himalayas. Now they are the highest mountains of the world as far as average altitude is also concerned. Not only because they have highest peaks, but they have more than around 14 peaks having height of more than 8000 meters. So that is why they are called as loftiest. They are snow-capped throughout the year, and so they have a permafrost kind of condition. And only the lower reaches of valleys are covered by some vegetation, but otherwise they have permafrost conditions, so there is no vegetation. And you will find that the snow line goes high up towards the east. So in Arunachal Pradesh, the permafrost conditions start beyond the altitude of 13 or 14,000 feet, and if you come to Kashmir, the permafrost condition starts at around 6,000 to 7,000 feet. So there is inclination of snow line from east to west, and that is why you will find that tourists prefer to go in Kashmir Himalayas, because they get snow at very lower altitude and it's very accessible. And they don't prefer to go in Arunachal because they have to climb up to 14,000 feet to get to play in the snow. Even in the Sikkim or Darjeeling, the snow is very high up and you don't get a good snow playing field, or even the skiing places. So most of the skiing places are in Himachal and Kashmir. So this is how this has got something to do with the usual fall of, or usual pattern of temperature in continental conditions. So this is the Himalayan system. Now geologically, Himalayas are made up of granites. I mean, at the base of Himalayas you have granites, and they are overlain by sedimentary formations and metamorphic rocks. So it's a mixture of things, and Himalayas are the barriers for climate. They protect India from the cold Siberian winds. This is one. And secondly, monsoon is controlled by Himalayas. If we don't have Himalayas, then the monsoon would have passed to China, and China would have been a monsoon cut region. So monsoons are guided by Himalayas, and therefore you get all the central Indian region and the northern Indian plains, they get rainfall because the monsoon is guided by the Himalayas.